Geoff Whitehead interviews Jesus on the subject of living in truth. This is session one. The interview took place in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia, on the 25th of February, 2013.
Okay, today we're interviewing AJ about living in truth. This was my idea. I thought this would be a good idea because at our last discussion, AJ noticed that I was having some intellectual problems with what he was saying. And I went home and I thought about a few things and I thought, well, what stands out to me with yourself and why I have to keep coming back for more.
even though you'd rather not sometimes.
Yes. Is related to a quote by Emerson, which is in... I actually Googled it to find out what the real quote was. It's always been a favourite of mine for about 20 years.
Yeah.
When people ask, you know, they've asked me when I was in my atheist days, what's your position, because they're ex-church people, what's your position, Geoff, now?
Did the atheist days happen after the church or before
the
church?
Yes, after.
Fair enough.
They probably started about 18 when I was... trying to teach a Sunday school class about Noah and God drowning all the people. And myself and this friend who is now a professor of psychology looked at each other. We're both 18 and we just said, what are we doing? What are we teaching these kids?
Yeah.
Anyway, getting back to the quote, what you are speaks so loudly that I cannot hear what you say. Now, I looked it up and it's either what you are or what you do. It doesn't... The point is the same.
What you are or what you do speaks more loudly than what you say.
Yeah, so you're familiar with that quote? Have you heard that before?
Yeah, yes, and it's obviously, you know, something that philosophers have said for many, many centuries, not just Emerson.
Yes, so I've got a few other ones here. Someone who I can't remember said, by their fruit they will be recognised, you know?
Yeah, I remember that person as well.
And the other one was, when confronted over breaking certain religious laws yourself, something in the Bible about the law being written on your heart, can you focus more on the law that is written on your heart rather than what the church is telling me is my appropriate mode of conduct?
Yeah.
Can you just before we go any further, can
I'd like to give a bit of background about that.
Expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, because... you see, those quotes came from the book of Isaiah and Jeremiah. And for me, when I was a child, one of the things that I noticed quite frequently was the inability of people, even religious people, to practice what they preached. They had a lot of difficulty doing that. Many of them were sincere in terms of what they preached, and they felt some sincerity about what they preached. But when it came to actually practicing what they preached all the time, they had a lot of difficulties doing so. And in my study in the earlier years of my life, a lot of it happened before I was 10, while we were still in Egypt. I was sent to the synagogue when I was 5 years of age to the age of 10, pretty much every single day aside from a few days of the week. And during that time, I had the chance to read all of the prophets. And the things that really stood out for me, even at that age, was the concept that was presented in these prophetic books about God wanting to change the heart of mankind. And he, in one of the prophetic books, in the book of Jeremiah, likens the heart of man like the heart of a stone. And God said, I want to change your heart into a heart of flesh. In other words, something that actually felt something instead of just being this stone-like stoic nature that most people, even nowadays, seem to still have. And if you look at these prophetic books, one of the books, again, the book of Jeremiah, talks about how God was wanting to write the law on the hearts of people. And in fact, this was all a part of what was promised as the new covenant, if you like, the new covenant between God and man. And the new covenant between God and man was basically that God would write, instead of the laws being written in a law book, God would write somehow the laws of, you know, the universe, if you like, and God's laws of love would be written on the heart of the person who had the relationship with God. And this impressed me greatly. And in fact, In fact, as I developed further, it became the main point of what I felt the Messiah would do. The Messiah would learn how to have this relationship with God strong enough to have the laws of God written on his heart. And so in my teenage years in the first century, I started looking for a Messiah who had the laws of God written on his heart. And of course, every Messiah that claimed himself to be one in the first century that I investigated didn't have any of the laws of love written on their heart, and in fact quite often had quite a lot of other laws which were all to do with errors and obviously violence and other problems that they faced personally written on their heart. And there was not any love coming out of them generally. There might have been strength and conviction, but not love. And so by the time I was about 18, I started having to contemplate that maybe I wouldn't meet the Messiah. You know, I went through this period of time in my first century life where I felt maybe, you know, maybe nobody understands this. And then I went through this process, a series of events occurred through 18 to 21 years of age that caused me to realise that I was the Messiah. And that was a very difficult time for me to come to terms with psychologically and emotionally. But eventually I came to terms with that because I realised that I was the only person understood that what God was aiming for was the laws to be written on your heart, the law to be written on your soul, not some law book that you follow. Mm. And so that's the reason why I focused on saying those particular things, and some of them got quoted in the.
So was there an actual, like, was it a healing on a Sunday or so? Was there an actual event that that you can recall that?
I went through a series of events from the age of 18 to 21 that started with disagreements with my father, Joseph, and disagreements about the role of the Messiah. My father felt that the role of the Messiah would be a violent one that would overthrow the Roman powers at the time and set up Jerusalem to be the ruling the government of the entire world, in fact, is what his belief was at the time. And I could not agree with that. And this is what he believed the Bible, or what we would call the prophetic books, the Old Testament now it is called, he felt it was referring to. Whereas I felt completely different to that. I felt it was referring to this law of God written on the hearts, changing the hearts of mankind. That's how real change actually occurs, not only to the human soul, but also to the environment. Because once you change the soul, the environment reflects the changes. So I became very firmly convinced about that. And my father and I had many disagreements as a result. In addition to this, there were a number of other events occurring in my life at the time. One was that there was a woman showing interest in me from a family who, she had six brothers and a father, and she was a girl who wanted to marry me, and I didn't want to marry her. I knew she wasn't, by this stage, I knew, had some feelings about the term soulmate, like that there was a soul, the other half of yourself that you could connect to. And that was the only person I wanted to marry. And so, and I realised at some point in the future I would meet such a person and attract her into my life if I kept progressing like I did. And so I rejected her advances, but she went home and claimed that she was raped by me. Yeah, and normally under those circumstances, you would either have been forced into marriage which was her underlying goal, was to force me into marriage. Of course, I said I had not raped her because I had not. And the family took the law into their own hands, if as the saying goes, and tortured me to almost to the point of death at the time. And I ended up with a broken back, broken hip, broken legs. I was dragged around behind a horse for quite a long period of time in the square of the town, Nazareth. Mm. And as a result of all of my injuries, it took quite a few years after that for me to recover. The first 2 years I couldn't walk at all. And then after that, I started to heal. As I progressed towards God, I healed every injury. But the injuries were quite bad. And the girl in question, finished up hanging herself in my own room. So this whole series of events caused me to ponder about how to change men's hearts. Like, how like the role of the Messiah being this role of showing people how to change their heart. Because I realised that unless the hearts of people change, the events such as the events that had happened to me during that period of time would continue happening. And, you know, of course, there were similar events happening all the time, all through the Jewish Empire that was run by the Romans, even though law existed. So even though, you know, you were not meant to do such things, of course, these things happened.
As is what's happening today.
Exactly, exactly. You see this same underlying problem occurring today. We've now got laws that fill rows and rows and rows of storage, and yet many of us don't even know the laws we're breaking. But unfortunately, we have so many laws, but we still finish up breaking many of them, because the law of God, the law of love, is not written on our heart. And so I realised, and that became actually after that period of time my primary focus, trying to have this, develop this relationship with God where I desired the law of God to be written on my heart. And of course I understood at that time that it involved love, because it was obvious to me that love, truth, and this state of humility of wanting this relationship with God and desiring it so much that you're willing to go through anything, I realised at that time that that was the key to everything. So I gave up a lot of studies that I was previously involved in. And of course, I couldn't work for that first period of time while my body was healing. As soon as my body healed, I left home and I lived in a cave for a number of years, just away from Capernaum. And then eventually, once I healed myself completely and was completely self-sufficient, then I moved to Capernaum, and I did not live in Nazareth from the time of 21 years onwards.
Okay, now my definition of living in truth is to live in truth is to live in accordance with what one may perceive as being the highest possible ethics and virtues. So before we can do this, I'll ask you what your idea of living in truth is.
Yeah, my idea of living in truth is very different to that. The idea that you've presented is what I would classify as a natural love idea. And it's a very high ideal. And in fact, very few people on the planet even ever live by those ideals. But the problem with natural love is that you can lose it as well as gain it. Like the problem, this is something that most people don't realise about love itself, the love that comes out of a human towards another human, is that it's fallible. It can break. It can change over periods of time. So I might love you today, right? But you might do something tomorrow that deeply offends me, and then I might not love you because of that tomorrow. And this is the problem with natural love, is that it is fallible. It can change, and it can actually be withdrawn as well as given. It's not always given, and it's not firm it doesn't have foundation really in a lot of ways. So I realized that quite early, that God's love had a solid foundation. It's solid, so solid that it was immovable. Everything based upon it is immovable. The laws based upon it, immovable. They cannot be broken under any circumstances. And once I started realizing this, I realized that if I really wanted to have an infallible love that was present under all circumstances, then the only way for me to do it was to actually have God's love in my heart. Not my own love, but God's love in my heart. So there had to be a way, I started feeling, there had to be a way of receiving God's love into my heart. Now, I recognized that people could give and receive love and feel the giving and receiving of love throughout their lives, as I had done with my family, with different family members in my family and different friends that I had. I had a good relationship, for example, with John, who's John the Baptist, and he has a cousin, and we loved each other dearly, and I could feel his love for me and he could feel my love for him. And we realized that love entered you, like love, or even the love of another person enters you if you allow it. And the love that you give another person enters them if they allow it. And so I started to apply these same principles to my relationship with God, understanding that that God's love had the ability to enter me and therefore transform me into having an infallible love, a love that wouldn't fail under any circumstances. And that's the transformation of the soul. That's what I called the new birth. That's what I called, and I referred to what Adam and Eve lost, or Ammon and Amen, the first human couple, lost as the death of the soul. Because what they lost was this loss of potentiality of experiencing this infallible love. And then when I came through this process that God had me in, I discovered again the process of how to gain this infallible love, the love that God has that enters you, that then turns your love to be the same as God's in the way that you express it.
So what do you define as being truth? And I have to at this point also acknowledge that I've also agreed to ask some other people's questions.
No worries, yeah.
That people have sent in to Lena.
Well, perhaps before we do that, I can just explain what I mean by living in truth as a result, because that was the question that you asked. And what I've given you is a heap of background more than the answer to the question. So the answer to the question of what is living in truth is, to me, it is living in from the soul, in other words, from your emotions and your feelings and from your heart, in everything that you do, living completely in harmony with God's absolute truth. That's what I feel living in truth is. And that's very different than living in your own truth, living in your own highest concept of ethics.
Because we all have different ideas and different backgrounds and different teachings,
yes,
and religions, which
distort our concept of truth.
Yeah.
So, for example, a person who's a Muslim may decide that, in his own truth, may decide that it's okay to attack at a Christian because he's not of his own faith. Mm. And a person who's a Christian may also decide this exactly the same thing, that it's okay to attack a Muslim because he's not of your own faith. And there's all sorts of justifications that have occurred to that throughout human history. Mm. But what is God's truth on the matter? Is it okay to attack anybody under any circumstances for any reason? You know, and what I've come to learn through this relationship with God is it's not. So there's God's truth. The ideal of God's truth is it's not okay to attack anybody under any circumstances in any situation for any reason, even if they rape your wife or murder your children or for any reason. It's not okay. From God's perspective, it's out of harmony.
You came to this understanding through your relationship with God, not
yes.
from any tablet that Moses brought down from a mountain.
No,
saying
because
you should not kill, or not from your parents.
Well, if you read the tablet that Moses brought down from the mountain, on one hand it says you should not kill, but on the other hand it says eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for a life.
Mm.
So it seems quite contradictory.
It is.
But if you look at the average person's perspective on the planet at the moment, they still have that same perspective, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for a life.
And many Christians still embrace both of them. I don't know how, but
exactly.
because they do contradict.
Completely.
Completely, yeah.
Yeah.
And because it's in the Bible, and this is one of our problems, is there are things that claim to be authorities of truth rather than how you found truth.
Yep.
Most people on the planet seem to think that to find truth you've got to go to a Bible, or you've got to go to a holy book, or the Maharishi, or even AJ. We need to go to Jesus and find out what's truth rather than finding it from ourselves.
Well, not finding it from ourselves, because I feel finding it from ourselves is also flawed. That, you know, if you look at all of the holy books that have ever been created, the Bible, the Quran, and the other holy books that have ever been created, even the ones that are in India and so forth, all of them have been written by somebody who had a concept. And whether that somebody was channeling a spirit or was actually having enjoying their own concept of being written down, it doesn't matter where the source was, it was a concept that came from somebody other than God. And the problem with concepts that come from somebody other than God is they are all flawed in some way. They all have some kind of flaw. Like, they're all based on natural love principles, but unfortunately natural love has flaws. It does, because you can lose it as well as have it. Mm-hmm. It's not a bad thing. I'm not saying that natural love, you know, is a bad thing to have, because God gave us this ability to love, which is a beautiful ability. So it's a gift that God's given us, this ability to love. But it's limited. It has limitations in that it's not constant. It has limitations in that it's not hasn't got a firm foundation. And so in the Bible, when I spoke of, you know, the foundation, if you like, of, you know, building a house upon the rock mass or upon the sand. That's what I was referring to. Do you build your house of love upon this whole concept of what's going on within inside of yourself, which is all to do with ethics and morals that you believe are ethical and moral? Or do you build your love based on the foundation that's solid, the foundation of rock, which is God's viewpoints of what's ethical and moral? God's love, if you like, and God's truth, the absolute truth of the universe. Do you build it on that? And even nowadays, I notice that a lot of people have a lot of disillusionment, I feel, with that concept that absolute truth is available. Like, they don't believe absolute truth is available, frankly. And because of that, they then feel like, oh, I've just got to focus on my concept of truth and my concept of ethics and my concept of morality. And if I do that, obviously, my concept will be very different to yours. Mm. And so at some point, we're going to come into conflict through these concepts. We're going to have to come into conflict because our concepts of ethics and morality are different to each other. Therefore, our concepts of truth are different to each other. And so we're going to have disagreements. Some of those disagreements, because of our concepts of truth, may become violent even. Now, this doesn't happen if a person has a solid foundation and are living in God's truth, not in their own.
Mm.
Now, that being said, a part of living in God's truth is accepting God's opinion of where you are currently, which means that I need to honour the fact that I have error inside of me and I need to respect the truth of the error. Now, what I mean by that is that I need to understand that inside of me at the moment, I have errors that are out of harmony with God and therefore out of harmony with God's absolute truth, but I need to be honest about them before I can change them. I need to feel them and be honest about them before they can even be released from me. Now, this is where I see a lot of people have a lot of struggle with their development in terms of love, because they notice something that's maybe evil or bad within them that they have judged as evil or bad, and they feel it inside of them that it's not right to have that feeling. And instead of trying to release the feeling, the reason why it exists within them, they then intellectually try to change their conduct. And this is the basic problem, I feel, of humanity at the moment, and the basic problem of most religious faiths, is that it's trying to change conduct of people who do not have God's laws written on their heart. And of course it's going to be a big struggle.
Like the monks that would whip themselves on the back with in the
Dan
Brown
of...
novel and...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, even so, self-punishment for breaking the law is the next step, because you feel so frustrated that the ideal that you have in your mind cannot ever be obtained by your own action and your own feelings and your own desires. And because of this difference between the ideal and the desire, there is then this tendency to want to punish yourself for never reaching the ideal. Now, in the first century, I did say that you must become perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. And I meant that as a truth. And I realized that once you become at one with God, you do become perfect. Your love becomes perfect. You don't also need to punish yourself. In fact, you realize that in punishing yourself, your love's now imperfect, because if you loved, you would never punish yourself or another for a mistake that you've made. What you would do instead is you would look at why the mistake was made, and you'd have to work your way through some other way than these intellectual ways that are presented currently. You have to work some other way through the mistake to get to the point where you no longer make the mistake automatically.
I was in a staff meeting last week and they were talking about kids working their way through emotions and how you can control them. And they said, you have to teach these children to intellectualize about their emotions so that they can behave in a rational way rather than an emotional way, because school's not the place to be behaving in an emotional way.
Yeah.
Now, your philosophy is the exact opposite. You say that the mind is a part of the soul rather than the... for many years, thought that I could control my emotions with my mind.
Yep.
And that if I changed my thoughts, I changed my feelings.
Yep.
But you say the reverse.
Exactly. I feel there is a fundamental flaw in the understanding of the human soul. And, you know, if we use the word psyche, you know, the Greek word for soul, the understanding of the human psyche currently is deeply flawed on the planet, because we have this idea that the intellect controls the rest of us, and that is not actually the correct. If we look at the way God constructed us, we have a soul and we have two bodies. We have a spirit body and a physical body. Now, in the physical body is the brain. In the spirit body, there's a mind. But the soul itself also has a mind of a sort. Now, the soul is not just mind, as a lot of people believe it to be. But the soul, in fact, the mind, if I could maybe have more clarity there, the mind is actually just a very small part of the soul. The soul has other attributes and characteristics and qualities that do not engage the mind at all, which are far more powerful than the mind. One of these attributes and qualities is emotion. It is far more powerful than the mind. The reason why, and it's demonstrated every single day in most people's lives, in that most people are dictated at some point in the day-to-day life by their emotions. And it doesn't matter how much training they've had with their mind in many cases, you put them in a situation that's really into their emotions, really getting into their, or triggering, or if, I don't know, like use the word, that word, I feel more, it's a word of pushing the buttons in the soul that are not healed. And you put them in a situation like that, now everything that was in their mind flies out the window. And they act in harmony with the emotion driving the soul. That's how they act, that's how they speak. The words come flying out of them, the emotion comes flying out of them. And later on they may regret such actions, because sometimes it's quite powerfully negative, even to the point where they might have decided to murder somebody even. But it doesn't matter what was in their mind. It's what's in their soul that drove them. It's what's in their emotional condition that drove them. So the emotion is actually more powerful than the mind. And there are many other parts or characteristics of the soul that are more powerful than the mind. And in fact, once you become at one with God, the mind becomes a very small part of the soul, if you like. It is still used. It is a part of the logical, intellectual expression of the soul. But the soul that's in complete harmony with God has all these other very powerful ways to determine truth, to understand the universe, and also to feed information to the logical part of the intellect and express that to others. So we need to understand that the soul itself is not subordinate to the mind, but rather the mind is subordinate to the soul. That's how God constructed us. The mind is a subset, a smaller portion than the soul is, in other words. So if you could think of your soul as that a circle that I've just drawn there, just the mind is that little bit there, right? The rest of it is all these other characteristics and attributes and qualities that are more powerful than the mind that will keep influencing the mind. But what does man do with that? What we do is we go, right, we're so afraid of the soul's emotions because sometimes they are very destructive and very powerfully destructive. There have been people who have destroyed millions of other people from a destructive feeling in their soul that have lived on the planet. So very powerfully destructive our soul can be. They become so afraid to delve into the powerful aspects of the soul that they decide that the mind must be used to dominate the soul. And that becomes the fundamental flaw in the development of all future development spiritually, the fundamental flaw in living in harmony with love and truth. So if we're going to live in truth, from God's perspective, we've got to remove from ourselves through a process. It can't be something that we just decide. It has to be a removal through a process from this mental intellectual dominance, this desire to control everything that's going on in this big soul that most of us have no even desire to understand because we're so afraid of it and we're afraid what's in it. And as a result of that, we become very mind-based and mind-dominant. Now, I'm not suggesting that you allow the soul full expression of all of its emotions, because if you do that, you will allow the soul full expression of hatred, revenge, potentially raping and all sorts of other things that might occur.
So this is where the mind can keep the soul in check as well.
Exactly. So the reason why God's given us this mind is so that we can logically examine things, and when our soul is in error, our mind can see it. That's the role of the mind. The mind has the ability to examine the soul and go, wow, you're in error there, obviously. So if there is a feeling coming up in the heart that I want to steal from you, my mind would logically go, would I like to be stolen from? And no, then it's probably not right for me to steal from Geoff. You know, if I wouldn't like to be stolen from, then why would Geoff like to be stolen from? That's our mind. But the feeling in the heart's going, I need to steal from Geoff because I need my next drug fix or whatever it is that is my underlying motive for stealing from you. Now, if I'm willing to honour my mind when it's logical, I can go, okay, I've just shown to myself here that even though I have this feeling in my soul, that there is something wrong with it. There's something wrong with this feeling. So it's not good for me to act upon it while there's something wrong with it. I need to fix what's wrong with it first, and then perhaps I can look at acting, right? And that was the way that God created our mind. Our mind was there, if you like, as a logical check upon error-based, unloving emotions that exist within the soul. Not as a role of suppressing those emotions, but rather in the role of identifying them and hopefully taking the soul through a process of releasing them. That was the role of the mind. But what man has done is switch the role of the mind. Mm. And so what we've done is we now want our mind to be dominate our soul. We are so afraid of the emotions of our soul, we don't even want to know what half of them are. And we want to use our intellect as a means of controlling them, suppressing them, allowing them in appropriate ways, socially appropriate or socially acceptable, you know, politically, religiously, and otherwise acceptable ways that our mind has become the dominant factor over our soul. So I feel this is the basic problem that people have, is they don't understand the rules associated with how truth works in the soul. They don't understand how God created it, and as a result of that, they've become intellectually dominant, trying to control the soul, and it's impossible. It's like your little toe trying to control you, because that's
so,
in the end.
So this would explain the hypocrisy that a lot of people see in our religious leaders, our politicians.
Yes.
An interesting thing that I heard John Lennon say was he was visiting the Maharishi, getting words of wisdom in India, and he lost interest when he realised that the Maharishi had more than spiritual interests in Mia Farrow. So he saw the humanity of the Maharishi, who was, I guess, he thought was divine. In some sense, he thought was, you know, someone who I can gain truth from. Then when John noticed his
sexual desire,
sexual desire taking over, he said, that's it for me. I was on the helicopter. I was out of here. So,
and I wouldn't call that humanity.
No, and that's what most people do, is we say that, I'm only human.
Exactly. And
is this a good excuse?
No, because God created us as humans to never have those kind of desires that are exercised out of harmony with love. So we have the potential as humanity to actually exercise desires completely in harmony with love at all times. So therefore, if I had a sexual desire for somebody else's partner, then that is out of harmony with love. And I have the capacity to live in complete harmony with love automatically at all times. God created humanity to be like that. So I feel when we use the term humanity, we're often using the term, and I'll use an old-fashioned term here, sinful humanity. And the reason why I use that term is because, you know, if you look at the old Greek works that refer to sin, it refers to missing the mark. And what happens is humanity often misses the mark of love, even though they have the ideal of love in their mind at exactly the same time as they're missing the mark of it. So there are many sincere people who constantly miss the mark of love.
I'm one.
Yeah, but there is also many insincere people who purposefully miss the mark of love for many personal addictions, you know, satisfaction of many personal addictions.
But it must be, I find it frustrating for myself personally,
yep,
in that I've always had fairly high ideals and morals and principles.
Yep.
And when I see myself fall short of the mark, you know, I get, do I beat myself up over this? You know, do I feel guilty? How should I deal with that?
Well, religion would teach you need to feel guilty.
Mm.
And certainly most of us who have grown up in Western societies do have underlying Christian beliefs about what, even though we're not a Christian anymore, many of us, and I've seen even many atheists have these beliefs growing up in a Western society, that it's appropriate to punish yourself for actions that you've taken that were mistakes or out of harmony with love that you've now identified as such. However, I don't feel punishment of anybody is ever very fruitful. We need to have more sincere desire, and perhaps I'll need to rewind a little there. Punishment actually causes other problems besides not being fruitful. It actually causes us to believe that as long as we punish ourselves, we should be able to keep getting away with poor behaviour. So it actually is almost a justification of poor behaviour if we're not careful. Punishment can finish up flowing into a justification of poor behaviour. So I feel punishment is invalid on a lot of levels, besides the fact that it's out of harmony with love of self, or out of harmony with love of another, depending on who you're trying to punish. Mm. Now, if you're trying to punish yourself, we need to look at the underlying reason why we're doing so. Usually it's because we are not able to cope with the underlying emotion that was triggered when we made the mistake. So in other words, we're not willing to go through the emotions that caused us to make the mistake. And instead, we're willing to go through the emotion of punishing ourselves rather than going through the deeper and more hurtful emotions generally, and often more traumatic emotions, of why we made the mistake. And this is our main problem when it comes to self-punishment.
Well, it's not obviously apparent to most of us. It's sort of like trying to find a needle in a haystack, you know.
Yes.
What caused me to have this particular makeup so that I have this inclination? What in my childhood, you know, this is a very hard thing.
You know, and because of that frustration, most people resort to self-punishment rather than praying to God about the frustration and attempting to work through the frustration as an emotion, because under the frustration will be what the actual feeling was, which would have been based in fear somewhere. And then as you work through the fear of that, you would have eventually found the underlying grief that would have motivated such behaviour. But most people are not prepared to go through that process of frustration first, feeling frustrated with the fact that you don't know, and then, you know, feeling like, wow, what's the point? And all those other feelings that come up as a result of that. And then going into this terrible feeling of, oh, I do know, and I'm just terrified of this person or this situation because of what something that occurred in my childhood that taught me to be terrified of those particular events. And then I feel about all of these childhood events that caused me to feel this such terror about whatever it was that has been the trigger of the actual event in this particular case, in our current life. And then once we get down to the grief, we have a big cry about all that and release all of that. And most people are not prepared to go through all that. But they are prepared to, you know, get out a stick and beat themselves with it for a period of time. Usually it's just a short period of time. For some people, it's a bit longer than others.
I think for a lot of people, they feel like they're having a nervous breakdown. They feel like they're out of control.
Of course. Of course.
If they delve into those emotions.
And this is also a misunderstanding of the soul as well.
Yep. Mm.
Because the mind is screaming, going, what's going on? What's going on? All of these emotions are there inside of me, you know, and I've got to keep control. I've got to keep the lid on them. And that's all based on a feeling called fear. We're afraid of what we may do in these emotions.
And afraid of what people might think of us.
Yes. Know. Afraid of judgment.
That fella's lost it. He's lost the plot now.
Yep. Yeah. Afraid of a psychiatric institution.
Yes.
Afraid of all sorts of things is what we eventually become. And in fact, we then use these fear justifications as a reason for us to never go to our emotions.
Mm.
And in fact, to try to get back the intellectual dominance of understanding what's going on in the mind. Now, how all that relates to truth is there are some basic understanding, basic rules that we need to understand as to how truth enters our soul. If we really want to ever become at one with God and we really want to ever live in truth as per the definition I've given, then we are going to need to understand how the soul works with regard to the absorption of truth and how the mind works with regard to the absorption of truth. And we need to see the differences between these two states as to what's really going on. And if we can understand these basic principles or rules, then we will understand pretty much everything that we need to do to be able to absorb different truth than we currently possess.
So a good definition for living in truth would better be living in harmony with love.
I'd go even further than that. Living in harmony with God's definition of love. And to me, and God's definition of absolute truth. Now, it's impossible for a human to know everything. That is the domain of God. So God knows all absolute truth, and I feel that there is almost an unlimited or infinite amount of absolute truth to discover. So all we can probably do as a human, if we're going to live in truth, is to live in the truth that we've learnt, that is the absolute truth about God at the moment that we've learnt it. Mm. Now, that obviously will be a changing proposition over time. So the more divine truth that I learn from God through this process of how the soul absorbs truth, then the more truth I can live in under that definition. And so when I begin, I might be living in hardly any truth when I begin that process. And then as time goes on and as I grow and as I change and as I absorb more and more of God's love, and that transforms my soul and truth enters my soul as a result of that transformation, now I have the ability to live in more truth as a result of the transforming effect of this love. So it's going to be a gradual process. It's not something that today you can say, right, from now on I'm going to live in all of God's absolute truth, because the reality is you don't know all of God's absolute truth, so it's impossible to live in all of it at that moment. But we do get to a point in our future where we become at one with God in love, and from that moment on, we are living in harmony with all of the absolute truth that we know at that point. So for most of us, before we reach that point, we know some absolute truth that we're not living in harmony with. Right? So for example, the absolute truth of non-violent nature. Most people on the planet have no idea how to live in harmony with that. Is they violently treat their children or other people, or you know, someone who's wronged them, you know, in a certain way. So this is an indication that the mind is telling you one thing. So the mind's telling you, there is some absolute truth, which is that you would not be violent with anybody under any circumstances at any time for any reason. That's the absolute truth. But my soul is saying, I want to be violent towards this person because they've wronged me or they've hurt me or they've done something towards me. And so what do I do with that? I need to say, okay, there is a discrepancy now between what I intellectually acknowledge that must be absolute truth and what I emotionally feel. Unfortunately, what most people then do is they go, no, the intellectual acknowledgement of there is no violence under any circumstances at any time with any person must be wrong. And they then try to come up with another intellectual answer, which is, if somebody hurts you, then you can hurt them back, which is eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for a life. And what does Gandhi say about that? It makes us all blind, you know, like sooner or later. So it's not very logical as a way of thinking, but it's a justification of the emotion that I feel. And so I accept it as truth, even though it's not logical.
Yeah. So I was going out with a girl who was the daughter of the moderator of the Uniting Church, and it was the time of the Gulf War.
Is this while you were an atheist?
I was still involved in the church,
right?
Under my own rational, under my own ideas.
Yeah.
But we were talking about the Gulf War and ideologically, should this happen?
Yep.
And his answer was, "Well, Geoff, we don't live in an ideal world." And I thought, now, should I accept that as a truth, so that therefore violence and war on another country is appropriate under certain circumstances, or is that a cop-out?
Well, you can see the problem with a soul that is not developed in truth is that it allows illogical reasoning. So while it may be true that we do not live in an ideal world at this time, and I think anybody on the planet would agree with that, it is not then subsequently true that we shouldn't act in certain ways to make the world more ideal. Mm. Right? What he is basically saying is we don't live in an ideal world, so we need to accept this unloving behaviour.
Mm.
And where's the logic in that? There's no logic there.
No.
In fact, if you look at the logical chain of events that most people use as intellectual reasoning, there is no logic present whatsoever. And then when logic fails completely, they revert to character assassination and character attack. Because their entire world is about to fall apart because their logical reasoning, which has been the construct of their mind, that hasn't ever touched their heart, if that falls apart, then what's going to happen? All of these big emotions they've got in their heart are all just going to fly out here and there uncontrolled, and nobody wants that. So you know, this is the problem, is once you start addressing the illogical reasoning that most people have as a result of the emotions that exist in their soul, they finish up getting to the point where they close down completely and revert to character assassination or character attack in order to avoid any further logical argument, because if they have further logical argument, something's going to have to change in their emotions, and they don't want that to occur. And so this is why we see a lot of people preventing themselves from absorbing truth. So the minister, while he was true in the statement, we don't live in an ideal world, the subsequent logic that he displayed, so don't do anything about unloving behaviour, we can't make a stand, we can't change something, is completely false. But a great justification for inaction in his fear, it's a great way to justify being so afraid that I'm not going to do anything about it.
Now, I'm lucky enough to have an Asperger's son, a son with Asperger's syndrome, and you've given me some tips on this. And so I tried to implement these, and so I addressed Harry, and I called this the New Deal, you know, as like the Americans did with something. And as you've pointed out, kids with Asperger's are quite good reflectors of how we're feeling emotionally.
Intensive reflectors.
Yes, and every now and then he'd go, because it's no easy task, I can tell you.
I can imagine.
So I can't stay on track. And when I lose my cool and I get impatient and I start to raise my voice, I get picked up.
Yeah.
Are you not doing the New Deal anymore, Dad?
Exactly. Where's your hypocrisy now, Dad?
And so then I have to look back and use a combination of my intellect as well as what emotions am I feeling that are making me feel exasperated at this point to treat my son in what's not an ideal way.
Yeah.
But it soon becomes apparent to me that when I do revert to not using the New Deal, that I've done the wrong thing.
Yes.
Because there's a price to be paid.
So you have an intellectual consciousness that something wrong has just occurred. And unfortunately, a lot of people on the planet don't even have that.
Yeah.
So that's a great start.
But I also have a consequence from him.
Of course. You have an emotional consequence in terms of what happens to him in his life.
Yes, which I then have to repair.
Of course. Yeah, if you love him, you would want to repair it, certainly.
So does the law of attraction also reveal to us where we are out of step with living in truth?
Of course. Like the way God works, God's always loving. And this is something that is not understood on the planet very well at all. You know, because we've imbibed these religious beliefs over many hundreds of thousands of years that, you know, God's this punishing, wrathful God, and you've got to appease him and you've got to sacrifice for him and you've got to, you know, slay some children for him, you know, as the, you know, many millennia ago they believed. And that then progressed into, you've got to slay some animals for him to appease his wrath. And then that went away for a bit for the Christians because they believed that God slayed me for them, you know, like And of course, all of these belief systems are based around the fact that God is a punishing, angry, wrathful God who needs, whose anger and needs to be assuaged in some way. And the reality is God's not like that. God is constantly giving us lots of assistance to actually absorb truth and be conscious, even intellectually, that we need to do something different. One of the ways is the law of attraction that you mentioned. It is a law that God established that works throughout the universe, exposing the soul condition of humankind to themselves, firstly, but also to others. And so that is one method. But there are literally hundreds of ways God provides help to help us become conscious. One of those other ways is that God provides a guide who's a person who's lived on earth, who's now in spirit form, who enjoys our company and enjoys our personality, who is trying to help us absorb more truth. And this guide is constantly trying to drop thoughts that are positive within into our mind to help us come to terms with some of the things that we're doing that are out of harmony with love. So, you know, these are great ways. And God's given us lots of different gifts, actually, to make sure that at some point we are exposed to our own unloving behaviour. And become consciously aware of it. Of course, a lot of people avoid each thing, but the reality is we can become more aware as a choice to even see intellectually these things. Some time ago, I wrote some material about the process of soul-based awareness, and I talked about the steps that are involved with intellectual awareness, and then I talked about completely different the steps that are involved in emotional awareness. Because they are completely different processes. But intellectual awareness is often first in the process because we've become intellectually dominant. And so if we're intellectually dominant, we need to become intellectually aware before our soul can ever become aware. If our mind is dominating our soul, the flip side of how it should be, constantly dominating our soul, then it makes sense that our mind will need to change first before we'll allow the soul to change. And this is the reason why adults need to go through this process in particular. Children don't need to go through the process like that so much. So the process of a child becoming one with God is much easier because they have less intellectual dominance of their emotional condition. And as a result of that, we can work with the soul much more directly. If you're going to heal the soul of a child, it's much easier to heal the soul of a child than it is to heal the soul of an adult who has had a lot of intellectual dominance controlling the damage that's been done to its soul. Yeah. So my suggestion to people in your position is the children are constantly reflecting back to you your own emotions. The key is to allow now the awareness that there must be something going on in my soul and then to go through a process of actually honouring what's in the soul, even though it's out of harmony with love, honouring it in the sense of feeling, allowing yourself to feel, wow, yeah, I am really frustrated with my son, actually. Sometimes I really feel like I just wish he wasn't in my life, actually. You know, that's the feeling sometimes people in your own situation have. And allowing yourself to feel why it's so frustrating. Because if you don't allow yourself to feel the frustration, you're not going to ever allow yourself to feel why.
No.
The frustration exists. So once you allow yourself to feel why, because I feel like my life is being controlled by this person. I feel like I'm constantly being, you know, demanded upon by this person. What's the emotions? And you start feeling the emotions. And once you start feeling the emotions and you start healing the soul, you'll find their behavior will change. And their behavior is changing is an indication that your soul has changed, not theirs, yours. What most parents try to do is change the soul, the behaviour of the child without changing their soul, the parent's soul. So the parent's focusing on changing the child to suit the parent's lifestyle rather than feeling like, no, there's things in me that will change. And if these things change, the soul of this child is more sensitive than my own. And as a result, the soul will sense. So for example, with your son, his soul will sense that you no longer have a hole where you can be manipulated emotionally by him. So when he attempts, he will get to the point where he won't even be able to attempt emotional manipulation. Because the hole in you is so patched up that his soul is sensitive enough to know that, yeah, Dad's like a rock on this issue. There's nothing I can do. I'm just going to either have to conform or leave. You know, that's his only choice. The third choice, which he often tries to engage at this point, is manipulate Dad, push Dad's buttons, try to get Dad to change and try to get... And this is what a lot of children do with their parents. They're constantly... They know that we're not a rock with regard to, you know, the holes that are in our soul. We're not immovable on certain issues. And they know how to manipulate those holes to get what they want. And so they do. And then they've got little spirits with them and sometimes big spirits with them helping them say the right things.
Teachers call it, they can sense blood.
They can. And any teacher knows, right, that you're in a room with 30 of them. Man, it's like sometimes it can be your worst nightmare.
Oh, yeah.
And this is why
when you lose it, they can see.
They can
see straight away.
Straight through you. And on top of that, this is why most teachers then revert to this idea or concept that we've got to control their minds.
Mm.
We've got to teach them how to control their emotions through their mind, because that's the only way the teacher gets respite from the barrage of emotion that is reflected back at them by their own law of attraction.
Mm.
By, you know, it's God's law, but by their own soul condition attracting these events in the classroom. And this is why most teachers revert to what you said, revert to this concept of mental dominance over the emotion, because they become so distressed at having to deal with all the emotions inside of themselves about what happens in the classroom, that the only way that they feel they can maintain being a teacher is to enforce intellectual dominance and correct behaviour through processes rather than changing the heart.
Now, one of the questions that somebody sent in, which is also a good, I think is a good question, is what are the benefits of living in truth?
Well, to be frank, I feel the benefits are like almost infinite in number. What we don't understand, and if we take the definition as living in truth, as what I've defined it to be, rather than what the average person would define it to be, and that is the definition of living in God's truth in complete harmony with God's definition of love and truth. The benefits of that are just incredibly amazing, because during that process, what happens is your soul transforms, and the power of your soul is so extreme that you can create universes living in this truth. So when somebody says, oh, what's the benefits? You know, it's not like my day is going to change. You're guaranteed your day is going to change. Every day will change once you live in harmony with God's love and truth. Every single day is going to be completely different. And you get to the point when you're at one with God where every single day will be the complete expression of your desire exactly as you had it in harmony with love and truth. And that includes creating universes in the end if you want to create universes. So it's far bigger than the earth. Our capacity of our soul is far bigger than the earth, bigger than the sun in its power, bigger than any physical thing in this universe, actually. This is why eventually we have to go to the spirit world to express our soul, because our soul is more powerful than the physical dimension in which we live. And once we get through all of that too, we find that our soul is more powerful than multiple physical dimensions that exist. And we have control of all of them eventually. So this is the future power of the soul. That's the eternal benefits of living in harmony with love and truth. And if we reduce that down to how is it going to benefit my life today, can you see, like, it's almost a moot point, that one. But if we analyse it, every single thing that happens in my life today, if I'm living in harmony with love and truth perfectly, as God intended us to do as humanity, every single thing I created would be in complete harmony with that love and truth. Every single thing that I created would be smooth, would be an expression of love, we'd only attract what we consider to be loving events. And even if you die, it's not necessarily an unloving event. So you know, we would attract a lot of just continuous loving events occurring. We would have control over everything around us, ironically. So ironically, when you give up the intellectual control, then your soul has some control for a change. And for most people, we don't feel like we have control because our soul has a lot of unhealed emotions which cause everything to appear out of control.
Mm.
Once we heal these emotions and they become in harmony with love and we've absorbed truth into our soul, once that has occurred, now everything that we do is in harmony with love. So everything we create is also in harmony with love, and we don't feel even stressed about any emotion. We enjoy every emotion we experience as a result. And we don't finish up having emotions of sadness or, you know, grief, fear, anger. All of those emotions eventually disappear once.
What point are you at?
In terms of comparison, in terms of, you're asking in terms of development.
Well, one of the questions was, what does it look like? What does it look like to live in truth? And I thought, well, the best person I know is yourself. and this is where I have to concede. You know, even though at our last thing, I there was a lot of stuff that you said that I just thought, no, I can't go for that. I can't go for that.
Yeah.
What I can't get past is your personal integrity.
Yeah.
And I don't know, and like I said, I was hoping Mary would be here today to... And so I thought...
But Mary's focused on the soul today.
Yes, yes.
So she can't be here.
But as far as I can observe, ironically, someone who is receiving probably more criticism than any of us have to put up with,
mm-hmm.
Is a person who I have observed to have the most personal integrity.
Yep.
In that, as one guy said, you don't just talk the talk.
Mm.
You walk the walk.
Mm. Although I get many emails claiming the opposite of that as well.
I'm sure you do, but it's not my observation.
Exactly.
For what that's worth. So what I thought I'd do, and it's a little bit also a light-hearted break and possibly a bit entertaining.
No worries.
So I've put together a whole pile of questions,
yep.
which might give us some idea of where you're at.
Yep.
As an example of someone who is, and... I know that you say that you are not quite there yet, but you're striving
yep.
and you're trying to live in truth. So what most people would regard as just being human, and I'm just going to do that because I'm only human,
yep.
You don't do those things. And so there's a list of things here, and because there's so many of them, there's a rule that you can only say yes or no, but if you want an explanation, it has to be like one sentence. Otherwise, we'll never get through.
But what about ones what about the questions where they're potentially needs clarity? What are you
going to do? Yes, we're going to come back to that.
Okay. Fair enough.
Okay, now a lot of these I know the answers for, but I think it'd just be interesting. Okay, first of all, do you smoke?
No.
No, why not?
Well, it's unloving to my body.
Right. Do you drink alcohol?
No.
Now, well, there's two things that most people on the planet do and don't think twice about.
Yeah, I used to.
Now, this is interesting. Would you support prohibition of alcohol? So do we control someone? If you think that's wrong, do we control people in what's wrong?
Do we support the prohibition of alcohol?
Yeah.
No.
No. So people have to take responsibility for themselves.
Yeah, it's their will being exercised. And so, yeah, I feel they need to be free to exercise their will, even if they want to exercise their will to damage their own brain.
So you would support the legalisation of drugs?
Yes.
Okay. Do you swear?
Yeah.
I've heard you quote people swearing, but I haven't actually heard you, use too many expletives.
Yeah, no, I do.
You do?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's okay?
Well, I don't see... They are just words to me. It's like...
What if someone is offended by it? What if somebody...
Well, taking of offence, as the Bible says, lies in the bosom of a stupid one. Like, if you're offended by somebody's words, then we need to examine why. Now, obviously, if I used my words...
With an emotion.
As an expletive with an emotion behind it, that's very, very different.
Mm.
So if I'm calling you all the names under the sun with this emotion in you that you are all of those things, then that's very different than just saying a few F words or C words or something like that about things. mind you, as you progress, you feel less inclined to do such things. Mm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And you only do that in expressing perhaps some emotion, even towards with God or within yourself. But for most people, I feel the issue with it is that we have so much judgment about the words because there is a lot of emotion behind the words, right?
Yeah.
Now, the feeling I have is if you have the emotion behind the words, now you're in a state of sinning. Mm. Now you're in a state of unloving behaviour. Mm. And that's a very, very different state.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Do you drink tea or coffee?
I occasionally have some decaf coffee. And I occasionally, when I say occasionally, probably once a month, might have a decaf cup of tea.
And is that because of an emotional need that you have, or you just like it? And
no, a lot of
times.
There's
no harm with it.
Probably the only feeling I have, Mary enjoys a decaf coffee or a tea, and she often will have one due to her fear. A lot of it is still, she might have one every 2 or 3 days. And occasionally, like once a month, I might join her.
Okay.
Yep.
Do you eat junk food? Do you go to Macca's and order fries?
Yeah.
And hamburger? Oh, well, you don't get hamburgers.
I don't get a hamburger. But I go to Macca's and order fries. Yeah.
You do? Okay.
Yep.
But do you eat meat? I know the answer to that. No.
No.
And just a quick answer why you don't eat meat.
Because it's unloving to animals and also unloving to myself. My body works a lot better without meat, and also it's unloving to the animals in that it causes a lot of pain, particularly the way that meat, you know, any death that's caused through somebody else forcing it is going to be quite painful.
So you don't consume any animal products?
No.
I
might occasionally have some milk-based product mistakenly. Okay. In the sense of, like, you know, it might be in something and I can't detect it. Usually I can detect it when I'm tasting.
So you don't have milk because you even disagree with the way dairy cows are treated?
Yeah, I feel that we have the potential to have milk if we wanted to, if animals were treated with love. Mm-hmm. But again, see, my definition of love is probably more extreme than others, in the sense that I don't feel keeping an animal just for the purpose of giving me something is loving.
Mm.
I feel an animal has a greater purpose than that. And if I'm just keeping an animal just for a selfish reason, then I'd find that to be out of harmony with love.
Yeah.
So for that reason, I don't have pets either.
So going down the road, do you dodge the cane toads?
Do I dodge the... Yeah, definitely. Mm. Yeah. We have lots of cane toads living on our property as a result.
Yes. But they're a non-native animal and they do kill other animals. Do you...
But they were introduced because of the unloving behaviour of mankind. Wanted to introduce them here in Australia because we wanted to control what happened with the sugar farms.
So would there be any benefit in putting them to death in a humane way, like in the freezer?
No. Once you bring your soul in harmony with love, with the way in which you treat all animals automatically become balanced in their operation with each other. In other words, cane toads wouldn't overpopulate. They would reduce in their population to be equal and in harmony with everything else.
Mm.
Also, they would not be poisonous for other animals to eat. So because the poison in them is a result of the attack that they've felt from humanity. And so once the poison in them is gone, then of course their bodies after they've died can be eaten by other things. So, and there's many of God's creatures are carrion type of creatures in nature, eat carrion. And so, it would all be in complete harmony now as an environmental issue. The reason why it's not in harmony is because of our emotion.
Mm. Mm. Now, I came to this conclusion in my early 20s. And as I told you when I met you, I wrote this little story about Jesus returning and giving a sermon. And one of the things he was going to say was, it's wrong to kill animals and eat them. So I'm with you on that one.
Yeah, yeah.
You avoid any animal products and leather, you know?
Yes, yep, completely. I found a place in Australia that makes shoes, vegan shoes.
Yeah.
And that's where I get my shoes now. And yeah, I avoid animal products pretty much completely. There might be times when I mistakenly get something and then realise afterwards that it had animal in it. It was just a sort of like something that I didn't know was in it or something like that. But most of the time, I can now feel that there's something animal in something even when there's a claim that there's not. So, you know, you become more sensitive to that as you progress. Mind you, I would not be against leather if leather was taken from animals that had died naturally. So I feel leather, and in fact all the products that come from an animal who has died naturally, there are many good products that can be made and used. So I'm not against leather per se, just like I'm not against, so I'm not against milk per se or any of those kind of things. I'm just against the way in which animals are treated. And as at the moment, it's very hard to find leather from an animal that hasn't been purposely put to death as a result of the food production industry.
Do you ever worry about your health and whether you're getting enough calcium? Like on the TV, we're not getting enough vitamin D now, we're not getting enough calcium, we need to eat dishes of broccoli and this many fish. You never worry about that?
No. I know that every imbalance in my own body is caused by an emotion. So while I might have a calcium deficiency, for example, in my own body, I've got to work through the emotion that causes such a deficiency. And I know that is a fear-based emotion. So I know that if I address fear, that the calcium absorption in my body will improve. So I don't see any point in going out and putting calcium into my body while I just need to deal with some fears, and it will be an automatic process after that.
So you address the cause, not the effect.
Exactly.
Okay, we'll get on some emotional things now. Do you get cranky?
Yes. Every time I get cranky, I realise that I've got an unhealed emotion that I need to work my way through. What I do is I allow myself to get cranky. I don't allow myself to get cranky with people. I just allow myself to be cranky. So if that means, you know, going down my tent and swearing my head off and bashing the pillow and allowing the anger to come up, and that's what I do. And once the anger comes up, very quickly after that, I find the fear is present. And usually you then start shaking and feeling the fear and crying. And then usually I get into the grief, usually fairly rapidly after that.
But there will be a point when you won't.
Yeah, that's correct. I find the more and more that I address, and particularly lately, because I'm working through a whole group of emotions associated with my own sense of worth of myself. And I find that most of our cranky emotions come from a lack of sense of worth in some way. And what I'm finding is as I'm addressing these particular emotions, I feel very, not cranky at all about all sorts of issues that before would have caused anger in me. Mind you, I've never been an extremely angry person, but that's something my parents will tell you, that I've never really been an extremely angry person, but I do allow the emotion.
Do you lose your temper?
I have lost my temper in the past. Probably the last time I've really lost my temper was probably in a way that damaged a physical thing, was probably 15 years ago or so. I think I might have smashed my car window or something, but it's very rare for that to occur now, and I don't see any problem with hurting or damaging
an object.
As long as the object isn't living. I don't see any hurt and damage if it helps you connect with your emotion so that you can connect to the grief that's under it.
But this is also something that will pass as you develop.
Yes, it will pass for everybody as they develop, yes. So it's not just for myself, but every person who allows the expression of their emotion and gets under their emotion to the point where they get rid of that causal emotion that triggers the event, then that feeling will pass, and the same event won't cause them any anger at all once that happens. And there's literally hundreds of things like that now for me that before may have caused anger, even just a feeling of annoyance or frustration. Don't bother me anymore.
Do you lie?
No.
There's not many people who can say that. If my wife was sitting here and you asked me that question, I'd said, no. She'd go, oh, right, And I don't think there's too many people, even though it's a very, it's three words, do you lie?
Yep.
Your answer, no, is quite interesting.
Well, when you are brave enough to feel all of your own emotions, there is no reason to lie. Did you see what I'm saying? It's sort of like the only reason why most people lie is because there's a certain thing that might happen emotionally to them if they don't lie. So, for example, if your wife asks you, you know, did you look at that woman that walked down the street the
other day? That's coming.
and you said, no, I'm not looking at her. Why would you lie under those circumstances? Only because you're afraid that now there's going to be some kind of argument with your wife as a result of her feeling, you know, confronted by the fact that you're sexually examining another person.
So often we lie to protect other people's emotions too, which...
Well, we say that.
We think we
That's
are.
Never the case. Mm. We only ever lie to protect our own emotions. So we don't lie. We never lie to protect another person's emotions.
Mm.
We always lie to protect our own. We often use the excuse that we're protecting another person's emotions, but the reality is we're protecting our own response to what their emotion may be.
Yeah. So. Now, I've grown up in, both my grandfathers were ministers, and my great-grandfather was a minister, and he was actually a moderator of the Methodist Church in Queensland for a while as well.
Yep.
So I've had this moral upbringing, but I've been to a lot of church sermons. I have never heard a preacher say, never, ever lie under any circumstance. Never, ever heard a preacher of any religion say that it's, that they always say, oh, it's a white lie, okay, but you don't even go for the white lie, do you?
No, there's a good emotional reason why ministers justify lies, and that is because they find themselves wanting to lie at different times, and they feel ashamed of that, and so, you know, they don't want to hypocritically suggest to somebody else something that they themselves don't do.
Yeah.
My feelings though, I don't have judgment about lies. I have a feeling of sadness about lies that when I see them and observe them in others, because what people don't understand is that lying actually reduces your ability to absorb truth. It reduces your ability to recognize truth actually. By lying, you're preventing something. You're trying to or attempting to prevent something that is actually going to be exposed if you didn't lie. So do you see what I'm saying? Mm. Now, unfortunately on the planet, there's a huge amount of judgment about people who tell the truth about their lives. Like, I just saw recently how Lance Armstrong admitted with, I think it was Oprah, that he, every single year that he won the Tour de France, he was doped.
Yeah.
And I felt like, wow, that's a great thing for him to do.
Mm.
Other people condemned him,
yeah.
Like, and you can understand why it's so difficult for a person to own up to the truth, because we often receive huge amounts of condemnation right from childhood about owning up to the truth. And in fact, when we were children, often we were physically and violently punished when we owned up to the truth.
Mm.
And quite frequently now, I get quite a lot of emails attacking me for owning up to the truth.
Because I've spoken
the truth about my past life or something. It's interesting, I find, because there's a lot of people who quote to me things that I've done in my life, and I said, yeah, where did you learn them from? Ah, yes, that's right. Yeah, I told you. You know, like, I told them openly that that I'd done these things in my life. And that's a, you know, there's power in that, because then you can change what you've done.
Yeah.
If you lie,
I've taken up that challenge of yours, the honesty one, and I've got myself into a bit of hot water.
You will get yourself in hot water, yes. Because the
attitude... And reprimanded by my wife for, you know...
Because of her fear, yes.
For not, you know, that this is a Christmas dinner, you don't have to say this now.
No, you do.
Well, that was what I said. It was... The situation, well, just a little anecdote here.
Sure.
The situation was my neighbour, who's a very good friend of mine, and we have been for years. He was saying that his girlfriend's son was invited to come to the Christmas celebration that night, and then to the supper afterwards.
Yep.
And that he said, I'm not interested. And so he gave him a lecture on why he should... respect these traditions.
So in other words, did not want to come.
No,
the girlfriend.
He didn't want to come. And I said, just casually, I'm with him. And he said, I made a point of telling him, you know, in front of everybody that this was unacceptable.
Yeah.
Or not good.
And why is it unacceptable?
And I just said, oh, that was pretty nasty.
Yes.
And I said, would you prefer him to behave in a way that is honest to him? Or would you prefer him to behave according to your expectations of how we should be. Which would you rather, the real
him?
I won't say his name, the real him or the fake him that's living up to what you want?
Yeah.
And I felt that that was a good thing to say, but because it was a Christmas, a Boxing Day lunch, it was inappropriate. So is it okay to withhold, you know, should I have just kept quiet? Or should I, are there moments where we should just say nothing?
Well, I know a lot of people around me would prefer me to keep quiet.
Not now, AJ.
But I believe there is a huge power in truth. And every time we don't speak it, we are making a choice for the other person to not hear it. So in other words, we are actually impacting upon their free will. They have the will to not hear it. Now, if a person says to me, I don't want to hear the truth from you, fine, that's fine. I don't have to spend time with you either. You know, and I usually don't spend time with such a person. And if a person loves truth and they love to grow, they will always want to hear truth. Truth is very refreshing, I feel. Mm. And it's also beautiful. It's beautiful because it has this power. That's why I said the truth will set you free. I didn't say in the first century that love would set you free. Mm. I said truth will set you free. Now, I talked about love all the time in the first century, but I never said love will set you free. Mm. The reality is truth will set you free. Truth has that power. Love doesn't always have that power. Truth is the thing that has that power. Because truth, once it touches the soul, will cause the opening to love. And that's where its power resides. Now, if I withhold truth, if I make the decision to withhold truth from you in an interaction with you, I am actually making a decision for you. I'm making the decision that you're not even going to hear truth before you've even made the choice to not hear it.
Mm.
So I'm actually deciding for you whether you're worthy of hearing truth or not. Mm. That's a very unloving thing to do.
Yeah. But so, you won't offer, like if someone's made it clear to you, perceive something
yep.
about somebody,
yep.
you're not going to run up and tell them.
No, because I can feel, once you start feeling the souls of people, you can feel whether the person wants to hear that truth or not.
Mm.
So that's their soul talking to you. So instead of you telling me, AJ, I don't want to hear that truth, I can also feel from a person, from their soul, that they have a refusal to hear that truth.
Mm.
Now, what I do under those circumstances is I pray to God. So I pray to God for an opportunity to share that truth with that person. And you'd be surprised, perhaps not, but most people are very surprised how rapidly the opportunity comes. I usually find the opportunity comes within the next 5 minutes, generally, depending on the strength of my desire, even if the person's on the other side of the world. So, you know, it's very rare that there's that desire for the person to engage the person with truth doesn't happen within a day if I have a sincere feeling that I want to share truth with them from a point of love.
Mm.
So I will share with them when they ask for the truth. I will share the truth with them. Now, many people are asking for the truth from their soul without even knowing. Many people are doing that. And once you become sensitive to the soul's desires, you will start responding to the soul desire rather than their intellectual statement. Does that make sense? Mm. So you will respond to the soul's desire to hear the truth. Now, there is only one occasion generally where I won't engage that, and that is if a person comes along to my seminars or a person comes along to my home, then I feel...
They've given you a license.
They've given me a license to speak the truth.
Mm.
So I suggest to anybody who comes along to my seminars or my home, don't come to my seminars or my home unless you want to hear some truth.
Mm.
Now, my point of my interaction with them won't be just to share truth with them. I want to know them. I want to, you know, express love with them. It's not about, to me, it's not about browbeating the person with truth.
Mm.
But I do feel there are times when during the interaction something comes up and truth has to be stated.
Mm.
In the case of where I'm invited along to something else, you know, to an event of somebody else's, then if I am personally engaged in a statement that I feel is out of harmony with love, I will express the truth. So under the circumstances where you were, in that Christmas dinner, I would have stated the truth. I don't agree with that course of action.
Mm.
I understand why you took it, because you want to control him and you want him to do what you demand, but you have an idea of, you know, what is good behaviour.
Mm.
and he didn't display it, but I can't agree with, you know, berating the person in front of a group of other people as a means of a, as a loving means of correcting that behaviour.
Do you ever exaggerate? I'm always accused of this.
I have exaggerated in the past quite a lot. And when I say quite a lot, compared to the average person, not much at all, but I view it as quite a lot. Nowadays, no, I don't exaggerate. But a lot of people feel my statements nowadays are exaggeration because they're not aware of the full truth of what's going on. So for example, you know, for example, recently in a talk quite some time ago now, I gave a talk about, I think it was about love in America, and I said that there are around 250 million abortions on the planet a year, right? Okay. Now, there's only documentary evidence on the planet to support there being around 48 or 9 million abortions per year on the planet. But that doesn't take into account a lot of things. Mm. It doesn't take into account things like the morning after pill, for example. It doesn't take into account emotions of the mother that are trying to reject their children while they're pregnant without going to have an abortion. It doesn't take into account a lot of decisions that are made by the parents that cause an abortion to occur purposefully, that are purposeful emotional decisions made by those parents. And it doesn't take into account that I can have a chat with my spirit friends and find out actually how many are happening. So the reality is there is around 250 million of them happening per annum. But documentary evidence supports only 50 million or so. So people would then think, oh, he's exaggerated. And no, I haven't exaggerated. I just perhaps know more information or have more information available to me that I can share about in that particular time. There are other times when I hear something from somebody else and I relate it as they've said it, and it turns out to be what they've related to me has been an exaggeration. So there's times when that's occurred.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Do you get frustrated with some people?
Yeah. And of course I will continue to do so until I remove inside of myself all of the reasons for that. Now, when I say, does it happen very often? No, it's very infrequent. And I'm a very patient person, and so a person generally has to do the same thing over and over and over and over again for quite some time before I become frustrated. But the frustration is, again, caused by an emotion, and what I've found recently is that it's a lot of times caused by an emotion that I'm getting used in some way by this person. You know, they're wanting me to feed an addiction and I can't feed their addiction. And also the frustration has a tendency to come up when I feel like I'm not allowed to say that I don't want to meet their addiction, but I can feel from them they still want their addiction met, things like that. So, sometimes I get frustrated.
Do you get frustrated with yourself?
Very frequently, still. Okay. And that's why I'm working through the emotions of worth, because I'm finding that they are very much linked to the feelings of frustration of self. Mm. Yeah.
Do you get disappointed with people?
Not with people, no.
So is that because you don't have expectations of them?
Yeah, I don't have expectations, but also the beauty of your soul is that once you can feel the emotional condition of people, you realise that you can't expect more than what their emotional condition would deliver. So for example, I know that, for instance, a lot of people that come along to seminars have no understanding of what I'm talking to them about at this point, at the soul level. Mm. I don't feel frustrated with them about that. I don't feel like disappointed with them. Does that make sense? Mm. Because I understand that, you know, they need to go through a process that eventually will open them and eventually they'll understand what's being said. I feel that disappointment in other people results generally from what you expect from other people. Mm. And I have very low expectations of people.
Mm. As the saying goes, expect nothing from others and they'll never disappoint you.
I don't expect nothing from others. Well, it's probably not true to say that. It's probably true to say that I am constantly trying to encourage loving behaviour in others. Mm. So while I understand that they might be unloving with me during the interaction, and I don't expect them to be unloving, I desire them to be loving. Yeah. Does that make sense? Mm. It's sort of like a different feeling or emotion. So I don't have an expectation, you have to be loving to me. Mm. Because if I had that, I'd get angry every time someone was unloving, and people are unloving to me very frequently. Mm. And so I'd get angry all the time if that happened. So I don't have an expectation of that they were loving. But that being said, I won't feel like having good interactions with them. I won't feel like having interactions with them if they are unloving.
Mm.
And I'll tell them, like, I don't want to have an interaction with you because you're just unloving.
Mm.
But it's not a feeling that I'm disappointed with them. It's just a statement of where they're at the time.
So do you and Mary have arguments?
Not really. We have quite often very emotional exchanges, I would call them, where she is expressing her emotion, I'm expressing my emotion. We don't fight in the sense of, like, you know, swear and carrying on with each other and call each other names.
So you don't become offensive to each other.
No. In fact, the attitude we have to each other now, and this is, you know, Mary initially sometimes did these things, but now the attitude we have to each other is an attitude of wanting to encourage the other to grow through this exchange. So whatever the problem is, we want to resolve it.
In that exchange, does your voice start to get louder?
Of course, definitely. You know, we might even be angry at times. You know, like Mary was this morning, was expressing about how, you know, something about her family and you know, how they've treated her. And she was yelling and crying and yelling and crying. And that's fine by me. I don't have any problem with that at all. And she's allowed to express her emotions, so she connects to it. Once she connects to it, she lets it flow out. It's fantastic. I do the same.
But not at each other.
No, we don't. Well, no, there are times when we'll be very emotional with each other, where we say, no, that behaviour was way out of line, you know, way out of harmony with love, that. And we'll be very firm about, you know, why it was out of harmony with love. And in fact, we've recorded a lot of our conversations even, that one day in the future, when Mary's brave enough, we might put them on the net for people to hear, because sometimes we swear and carry on and so forth. Not at each other trying to pull each other down, but we do make statements that are truthful about what the other person has done. Does that make sense?
Mm.
And so if the other person has sexually projected at somebody, we're saying that's, you know, that's a lack of faithfulness. That's infidelity. You know what I mean? You can say it's effing something else, but it's not. You know, so, you know, we'll express ourselves honestly, but we don't get engaged in resentment or hatred with each other to such a point, or to any point, where it would be damaging to the other person. It's always with the underlying constructive goal that the untruth is exposed, so that the person, and exposed well enough so that the person who needs to work on the untruth, whether it's myself or Mary, needs to address it. And we are very firm with each other about addressing it.
Mm.
So we don't let each other get away with not addressing something for a long time anymore.
Mm.
So, you know, so if I'm not addressing an issue that Mary feels is an issue, she'll be on me about that issue.
Yeah.
And not unkindly, but just, no, I think...
And you don't mind it when she does that?
No, not at all.
And she doesn't mind it when you...
Not at all.
...pull her up?
Not at all. We love it, actually, because we see each other as an assistance to each other.
Mm.
We see each other as a friend.
Mm.
We don't see each other as an enemy.
Okay.
We see each other, like, I see Mary as a great way for me to address issues that I still have outstanding. And whether she helps me verbally or even if she helps me through some kind of unloving behaviour, I still see her as a way that I can address these particular issues inside of me. I will address the unloving behaviour as well, but I will also look at why I'm attracting it, what's going on inside of me that causes me to attract this unloving behaviour, because there is something, always something.
Mm.
So, yeah, we have a very, very frank, honest, open relationship with each other.
Mm.
We know everything about each other, what we think, what we feel. In most moments, we know everything about each other because we openly express to each other what we feel.
Now, I just went to the toilet and I put the toilet seat down because my first wife, who I was married to 20 years ago, this was an expectation of hers, and I still do it.
You were trained well.
I was trained well. Do you put the toilet seat down in consideration, or do you...
Yeah,
this is just a silly one.
When I go to the toilet outside, I stand up if I'm doing a wee. But if I go to the toilet inside, I always sit down. But it's got nothing to do with...
Oh, so you don't have to worry about putting it up. Well, this is just a funny thing that between husbands and wives...
It's got nothing to do with...
Always an issue.
Either. It's a practical thing.
Okay.
As any man knows, when he's finished doing his wee and he shakes things a bit, the urine goes everywhere and eventually it stinks. And I don't like things stinking, so I sit down. Does that make sense?
Yep, I think we're going into too much detail.
But of course, I'd prefer to go outside. I'd prefer to say go outside and wee on a tree or something. And
You have the luxury of doing that.
Yeah.
I don't. I live in suburbia. Do you get mad at people?
No, I get mad about things sometimes still, you know, situations, I suppose you'd call them, but I don't get mad at people because, again, like, you only get mad at people because you have an expectation that they act differently than what their soul condition would state. Mm. So it's a bit like, if I know your soul condition and I can feel it, then I know how you're going to act. I know when you're going to lie to me, and I know you're going to steal from me perhaps, and I know that there'll be times in our interaction where you'll try to get away with, you know, things that... I know, because I can feel what the injuries are. Mm. And I know where you'll try to get away with it. So, for example, with yourself, I know that when it comes to a discussion about a woman, you're always going to favour her. You know, I know that because there's that injury inside of you that I can feel. Mm. And so I know in a situation where there's me and a woman and we've got a problem, you're always going to favour her. I know that I'm not going to get from you good advice as a man that's ethical, because I know there's this underlying taint. Does that make sense? So I don't expect it. I don't expect it from you either. Mm. And so you can't, you know, you don't get angry with people when you know that what they're probably going to deliver.
Mm.
Now, there are very few occasions where people surprise me, and I just revel and enjoy the surprise.
Mm.
But aside from that, the soul condition does drive the behaviour of people. And you will always get what the soul condition dictates until that person is willing to change their condition. The thing that I really enjoy in people is their desire to change their condition.
Mm.
You know, I feel that's a unique quality that very few people on the planet actually have at this point, and I'm hoping it would improve.
Mm.
But I love people who desire to change their condition, no matter what their condition is when we begin.
Mm.
So they can be a murderer or a rapist or any... you know, child abuser or anybody, I feel if they're wanting the change and they have a pure desire in their heart to change, then I'd love to engage them.
Mm.
So, you know, I feel quite strong attractions to people who have that underlying heart desire to change.
Mm.
Yeah.
Do you respect other people's beliefs?
Always.
Now that's interesting, because when I'm asked that, I say no. I say, how can I respect the belief of someone whose belief would make them fly an aeroplane into a building? How can I respect that person, but I don't respect their beliefs because I think that their beliefs are in error? That would be my reply.
There's a difference between knowing that their belief is in error and respecting their right to have their belief.
Yeah, the question is, do you respect their beliefs, not them?
Well... No, I respect their right to have their belief. I respect the fact that they're allowed to have a belief of error. Under God's universe, they're allowed to run a plane into a building.
Yeah, okay. But you can't
I don't agree with it.
You don't agree with the belief in itself.
Not at all.
No.
It's a totally unloving belief.
Yeah.
But I respect their right to have one, to have it. And I respect it also because I know how it got created.
Mm.
I know all of the different emotions that had to go into them to get to have that belief created. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And a lot of times the emotions come from deep injuries within their childhood, but not only from their childhood, it comes from society. A lot of our emotions that cause people to act in ways that they act come from society's dominance of the mind without honouring emotion, without helping people work through their emotional condition. The reality is, if we as children were taught how to address emotion, there'd be very little bad things happening on the planet right now.
Mm.
The main reason why the bad things are happening is because most people are never taught how to handle emotion, and they become totally uncontrolled when they deal with their emotion, or when their emotions are triggered to the point where their intellect can no longer dominate them. And I feel that if we were taught right from childhood a different way, then every single person on this planet would be secure in how to handle every emotion, and they'd never damage another person with their emotion.
Do you respect someone who hates you?
Yes.
Do you hate people who misrepresent you and tell lies about you?
No, I don't hate anyone.
That's also something that very few people would feel comfortable in being able to say.
At the moment, I have like millions of very, very dark, evil spirits attacking me fairly constantly, and I don't hate any of them. I have a lot of compassion for them as to how they got into their current condition. I also have quite a lot of compassion for them in the sense that I know they're further damaging their condition as well, which is causing them even more pain by their actions. And I am very hopeful that my own actions of forgiving them will have some effect on them. And in fact, what I've found generally is that forgiveness has a large effect on people. So yeah, I don't feel hateful or resentful towards people at all. I feel quite strongly that every single person believes themselves to be acting in a manner that's, you know, in harmony with their desires. But I feel quite strongly also that most of the desires on this planet are out of harmony with love. But I don't have an expectation that people act differently. I have a desire they act differently, which is very, very different.
Yeah. So do you criticise people?
It depends what you call criticism. If you call criticism trying to denigrate and pull down a person just for the sake of the activity, then I never do that. If you call criticism telling a person the truth about themselves that they don't like, then yes, I do that quite frequently.
So that's, do you correct people? Are you ever mistaken?
Yes, frequently.
Have you ever apologised to someone for making a wrong assumption?
Yes, frequently.
Do you doubt yourself?
I still doubt myself at times, but it's becoming less and less. The reason why is I'm realising more and more how correct my own assessment is of things. As I get closer and closer to God, it's almost like you give up your own assessment of things and you absorb God's assessment of things. So it's almost like you don't have, it's like your opinion is not your own, it's not, you know, an error-based opinion that you're holding onto for your own sake. Your opinion is based around God's truth or God's love about that particular situation. So I'm perfectly happy to condemn situations. For example, a situation where somebody is completely unloving to a person. I'm perfectly happy to say that is wrong. And I can't agree with that at all. But I respect the person's right to make the choice to do the wrong thing if that's what they wish.
Do you wish you had more personal assets?
In terms of physical assets? No.
Nicer house? Pool? No. Swimming pool? Nicer car?
No.
No desire?
No.
Except if it might benefit the enabling divine truth to get out.
Then it wouldn't be a personal asset anyway.
No, it's not
if you're asking me whether I'd like to have $1 billion at my disposal, yes. I could do a lot with $1 billion. I believe I could do more with $1 billion than any other person on the planet at this point in time. That it would be in harmony with love. So I don't have a fear of having assets. I don't have a fear of money.
Would you justify your own personal jet with that $1 billion?
No.
It would enable you to do these things faster.
No, I don't agree with that. See, what enables me to do things faster is the development of my soul, not having a jet. So the reality is anything I choose to physically do doesn't help anything. What I choose to do emotionally, what I choose to do inside my soul is what transforms everything around me. So the reality is if it's to help me, I don't need anything more than what I currently have. If it's to help people on the planet, then I need a lot more than I currently have. Because the reality is it would be lovely to translate, for example, all of the divine truth into every language of the earth. I'd love to see that happen. I'd love to see every single video that we've ever done subtitled into every readable language on the planet. I'd love that to occur. Mm. I'd love to see children being taught the principles of divine love in schools right the way through every nation. I'd love to see that happening. That's going to take quite a lot of resources. Mm. You know, I'd love to have training sessions with people where people can come and forget about their needing to earn a living for the week, at least for the week, to learn, you know, where people are relieved from some of their daily stresses of life so they have enough emotional space to be able to absorb some more truth. Mm-hmm. Now, to do that requires funds as well. Mm-hmm. So I'm not averse to having lots and lots of funds, mm-hmm. but I don't, like not myself for... and Mary, very happy how we live our life, and we don't see any purpose in having anything more materially for ourselves. Yeah. We'd see a lot of purpose in having more to demonstrate the truth to others. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On a day-to-day basis, would you say you're more generally happy or sad?
No. Well, at the moment, I'm going through a lot of, like I said, emotions of unworthiness and stuff like that. So, of course, I'm experiencing a period of sadness. Mm. And this is what you find when you're progressing on the way, you know, God's way, is that you will go through periods where you're extremely happy, you'll go through periods where you are extremely sad. Sadness doesn't overwhelm me in the same way that it overwhelms most people, and that's the reason why most people don't want to feel it. When I allow sadness to overwhelm me, in the sense that mm. I allow my expression of sadness, but because I allow it, the course of a day, I often have a lot of joy through most of the day and then a little bit of sadness during the day. Does that make sense? Whereas the average person is not connected to any sadness during the day generally. But then also they're not connected to much joy during the day either as a result, because you can't suppress one emotion over the other. But what I feel quite confident with is that when I began this process 15 years ago, I was a very, very sad person, very sad, very morose, wanted to really die. And now, yeah, I'd never have those kind of feelings ever. Mm. No matter how extreme the emotion is that I'm working through. And I am working at the moment through some very extreme emotions that I can't explain, because no one else on the planet's ever going to have to work through them. Mm. And it almost demeans the emotion by trying to explain it, because most people believe they understand what I'm talking about when they have no concept of it. But even with all of that, I still don't feel like I want to die. I feel quite strongly all the 14 who came for a very, very good purpose. And I have had to go through a lot of pain in order to get to my current condition, and I'm not going to give up my goals under any circumstances, no matter how much opposition I receive, just for the sake of alleviating some pain. Mm. I don't have an addiction to alleviating my own pain, alleviating my own sadness, or alleviating my own fear. I'm perfectly happy to embrace those emotions, but I still want to meet the desires that I have, which is to help as many people on this planet have the freedom to develop emotionally to the point where they want to and desire to come into harmony with God's love and truth. And I feel that the more I can do personally doing that, the less others will have to do as a result. Mm. Mm.
Have you ever changed your mind about things that at one time you believed to be true?
Definitely. That's a given. You have to do that. You see, if you think about it, here we are, mankind. So generally, we're here. Here's God. Let's say God's way up there, infinite, up there in terms of love. And here's our condition of love. Here's our condition of truth. There's what God knows about truth. God knows everything about truth. We know very little about truth. Now, For myself to grow in truth, I have to give up things that I sincerely believe are true in order to absorb the things that God knows are true and that I didn't know about. So I am going to constantly have to change. I am going to constantly have to reappraise my assessment of truth. I'm going to constantly share different truths than I shared a year ago, 2 years ago, 5 years ago with others as I do that. Because that's the nature of divine truth. Divine truth is, God's truth is, that it is absolute, and my position on God's truth is that I am relative. I need to learn more of it. Mm. To learn more of it, I have to give up old things to learn the new. And that has to happen in the soul. I can't do that intellectually. I have to actually do it as a feeling and as emotion. Mm. So before I felt something as true with my whole heart, and then I go through a process emotionally, which causes me to release an error, and then all of a sudden I realize that thing that I felt with my whole heart was true, it's not true anymore.
But what if you've addressed a whole seminar of people and you've told them something that now you...
Then I'll address another seminar of people and...
And correct it.
Okay. Yeah, and I've done that. Mm. Yeah. And the more you progress, the less you have to do it, because obviously the more statements you have in harmony with truth, mm. the truth's like a foundation. God's truth is like a great big foundation and building blocks, in that when you learn a new one, it adds to the old one. It doesn't often contradict the old one. Does that make sense? Mm. So as you learn more and more divine truth, if it is God's truth, you won't have any contradictory nature in the truth. But if it was my own idea, then certainly there would be a contradictory nature in the truth. I mean, I'll have to say, no, that was wrong. This is right. Mm. And if I get criticized for that, then all I'm doing is getting criticized for integrity.
Yep.
Which is a strange thing to criticize a person for.
Mm. Would you let a homeless person stay on your property?
Probably not.
Mm. Yeah, okay. Mm. Do you give people a second chance?
Can I say why?
Oh, yes, okay. Yes, actually, because I had ones that if you said yes, some more hypotheticals.
Sure. And many people would become homeless for a lot of reasons and choices that they've made. Now, what I would love to do is talk to that person about the reasons and choices that they've made, the physical, emotion, and emotional choices that they're making in their life that caused them to become homeless. Mm. I feel by having them live on my property is only trying to address the effect. It's not actually addressing the cause.
Okay.
So I would want to instead focus on the cause. The reality is their soul is as powerful as mine.
What if they've walked all the way because they've heard who you are, they've walked all the way to your house?
Well, now they have a demand.
And it's 6 o'clock at night.
And now they have a demand, and now I can't agree with their demands. Hmm. They can't demand that I... Like, we have many people that email us demanding that I respond to them. I'm sorry. If you email me demanding for a response, you're not going to get one. Mm. Because I can't feed your addiction that you can demand something of someone you don't even know. Mm. It's a gift. My time is a gift. Mm. My property is a gift if I give it to you. It's a gift. As soon as you demand it, it's not a gift anymore and I can't give it. Mm. Okay. So there's principles that are involved.
If you were on the beach and you saw a woman with a really nice figure and in skimpy underwear, would you look twice?
Would I look twice?
This is a man question.
Most of the time, as Mary knows, I don't look at all because I don't even notice her. It's hard to sort of explain to a person who notices it all the time. The main reason why I don't notice her is because I feel sexually connected with Mary. Mm. I feel like her body is the thing that I am sexually connected to. Her soul, and in reality, it's her soul that I'm connected to. That's the feeling that I have. And so the only time that I would ever see what's going on with someone else is if there was a projection coming from them towards me that I felt some level of discomfort of, or some kind of thing I wanted to address with it. Mm. So if that woman was sexually projecting at me, look at her, then I might look at her and I might even be tempted to go up to her and say, why did you do that? Mm. do you know what I mean? Like, it might go up to, why did you want me to look at you?
Most men would just say, oh, look, I'm only human, you know, she's got a good figure.
You mean
I'm allowed to look.
Are you mean you're only sinful? That's okay. Not only human. Remember I said that. So humans have the capacity to be perfect.
How is that sinful? Are you violating that person by looking at them?
As I said in the first century, any man who looks at a woman to have lust and has lust for her in his heart, he has committed adultery in his heart.
What if they say it's not lust, they're just admiring...
No, he has shared sexual energy with her. And that is an exchange of sexual feelings. And that is promiscuity. And there's a reason for it. So I'm not judging it. I'm just saying that's what it is.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is to the man is you need to look at why you have that. And why you have it will be based around all sorts of emotions. Some of it might be sadness with your current partner, that she is not sexually, you know, involved with you, that she doesn't really want you. Some of it might be sadness about something that's happened in history. Something might be in that woman emotionally that attracts you that is not in your partner. Does that make sense?
Mm.
And if you're honest about all the things, both with yourself and your partner, you'll be able to work through a great variety of emotional reasons as to why you felt drawn into looking. Does that make sense?
Mm.
So if I feel drawn into looking at somebody, and there's occasions where that may happen, you know, if we're walking along a beach and there's a sexual projection coming from somebody, it doesn't matter how they're dressed, I will look at them and go, what's going on with you here? You know, like, that's the feeling. And I say to Mary, this woman's projecting at me, you know, and, you know, I don't, you know, can you feel what's going on with her? And we discuss it. We discuss what's going on, like, as to why it was so intense that it caused me to notice. Because most of the time I will not even notice. And Mary often comments that I wouldn't notice a naked woman walking along the road. And I feel eventually on the planet is that once you are fully connected with your soulmate and you're in a condition of love, you wouldn't even notice.
Mm.
You notice she's not dressed, but you wouldn't sort of have a feeling of lust or desire for that inside of yourself as a result. Does that make sense?
Mm.
And it would actually be safe for women to walk around naked and safe for men to walk around naked under those circumstances.
Mm.
Yeah. So, and that's, I feel, how God intended it in the end.
Well, I don't think in those Brazilian villages where everyone walks around naked, I don't think they'd sell too many Playboys there, would they?
Exactly. And the reality is there's very few sexual projections as well in those environments generally because they are very committed to the relationship of the soul individually with the people. So if they are in a relationship with a woman, it's because they desire her, not they don't desire every other woman and they're just taking this woman because, you know, she's a fallback position.
Do you think because this is something and sexual things are something that church people have felt guilty about for centuries, do you think this suppression has amplified?
It has amplified it terribly. It has caused a huge amount of problems. The sexual suppression of men and women have caused innumerable problems on this planet. And the sexual suppression of children by parents causes innumerable problems with their sexuality later in their life and causes them to be attracted to all sorts of sexual situations and positions, often that are very unhealthy for their own soul, as a direct result of the suppression that has occurred in the history. And one of the big emotional difficulties of resolving sexual problems on the planet is the emotional difficulties relating to shame with regard to sexual issues. There is huge amounts of shame, and this shame causes two responses. It causes rage and therefore rebellion, or it causes suppression and therefore like suppression of sexual desire.
Mm.
And I feel society is exhibiting and expressing both of those extremes.
Mm.
You see society expressing sexual liberation and rebellion, and you also see society at the same time many times expressing sexual suppression. Like if you look at the general culture in the USA, for example, you see this going on amazingly so. Like on one hand you see the sexual liberation, the rage, the anger, you know, the having sex under all sorts of circumstances going, but then you get the Christian majority which defines what happens in the USA politically, and you know 70% of the population is generally that, and so you get all of this sexual suppression, condemnation. You know, if a politician has an affair, man, it's like he's slaughtered, you know, like it's not like nobody understands the reason why, nobody even looks at the reason why, nobody even examines whether it's affecting him as a politician in terms of his decision making processes or any of those other questions that are viable questions to ask, because there's so much judgment and rage about the suppression of the sexuality. Now, I'm not suggesting that a person who's adulterous hasn't got anything to work through, because they do. But I am suggesting that our judgment of it causes far more problems than it resolves.
Mm. And probably the initial thing that caused that was what we started talking about, where somebody's intellect decided this is an appropriate code of conduct. Women yes. need to wear skirts down to here.
Yep.
And the intention was good. The outcome was very negative. Yes.
And often the intention covers over the emotional injury. So, for example, historically, many priests have condemned women for any display of any part of their body, let alone their breasts or, you know, their vagina or the bottom or whatever. And the reason why is because many men are terrified of a woman's power over them sexually, right? Mm. And as a result of this terror that many men possess, many men then want to control how a woman expresses herself sexually because they're afraid of their own response to the woman. And so what they then do is make a whole series of rules for the woman as to what is modest behaviour, never addressing, of course, the underlying fear they have about why they feel drawn to the woman who has immodest behaviour.
Mm.
And so they never, so they have all this cloak of modesty placed over the woman in order to prevent a whole heap of dark emotions that exist in themselves. And this is a very unproductive way to get closer to God. Mm. You can't get closer to God by covering over the things you feel. God knows what you feel, and it's going to be impossible for you to cover them over. And this is why eventually many of these ministers and priests have become pedophiles and other examples of sexual deviancy
yeah.
because they've covered over these underlying feelings for such a long period of time, they don't know how to express them and they don't know how to address them or deal with them. And eventually they come out in some kind of deviant behavior.
All right, well, I've got a few questions here, which I think we might have a break because we're probably a bit hungry.
That's fine.
And we'll have a break and have something to eat and then ask, because I feel like I need to ask these questions that Lena's given me.
And also perhaps we need to discuss a little bit more, I feel, about how truth enters the soul. Like, I feel this is a very important part of this discussion because I feel there are some basic rules about the soul and how it works that mankind needs to understand. And I feel that we need to discuss those basic rules in a bit more detail, because it will help us come to terms with why it is that we think we want to do something right, but we finish up doing something wrong.
And then we can
come to terms with how we can correct that. There's a method or a process that we can go through to correct that. And it's very important, I feel, for most people listening to us in this discussion to start to understand some of those basic truths.